saying to this particular audience that evolution can happen over fairly short timescales. So one example and a set of traits that often evolve really quickly are these dispersal-related traits. And so some examples of rapid evolution of dispersal-related traits can be seen in these Australian cane toads. So if you go and position yourself along sort of the leading edge of their dispersal front through Australia, the first individuals that arrive tend to be the best dispersers. They have the longest legs. And then gradually through time, their leg length sort of decreases in that particular area. Flightlessness has evolved over 1,000 times in island birds, and this is also a process that is thought to happen pretty rapidly. And another nice example can be seen in seed dispersal traits in island plants. So among wind-dispersed plant species that reach oceanic islands, there are some nice examples where the pappus size decreases over just a short number of generations. So one particular species that can be nice for thinking about dispersal is the monarch butterfly. It is well known for its very long distance migrations within North America. And so in North America, it will overwinter at these sites in central Mexico. And then in the spring, it will colonize pretty much all of the continental United States and part of Canada over the course of a couple of successive generations. And then in the fall, those individuals that have colonized North America will turn around, and individual butterflies as far north as up here in Canada will fly all the way back to the overwintering sites in Mexico. So individual butterflies can travel up to 3,500 miles in a single migratory journey. So less well known about monarch butterflies is that there are also a bunch of non-migratory populations established throughout the world. So you can find year-round breeding resident populations in Central and South America and the Caribbean. The idea here is that their milkweed host plants are available to them year-round, and there's really no impetus for them to migrate. And then much more recently, within the past 200 years or so, monarchs have spread out of North America and crossed the Pacific Ocean. So they're now established on nearly every single Pacific island group. And in all of these island groups, they're established as these year-round breeding, non-migratory populations. The one exception to that is in southern Australia, and I'll talk a little bit more about that later. And I should also mention that this their crossing of the Pacific is thought to be an actual natural dispersal and not human-assisted. So people have noticed for a long time that there are these differences in the migratory behavior of monarchs, and people have seen these strong phenotypic differences between migratory and resident populations of butterflies. So Sonia Altizer and Andy Davis in 2010 showed that in North American migratory populations, their forewings tend to look something like this. So they're pretty large, they're really elongated and pointy, they have a high aspect ratio. And the thought there is that they're good for gliding flight and the sorts of long distance movements that they have to make in North America, whereas butterflies from places like Puerto Rico have forewings that look more like that. So they're sort of shorter, rounder, and the implication is that there's sort of a trade-off between maneuverability and long distance flight. They also importantly showed that that variation is heritable. More recently, Nan et al. Did these whole genome scans of migratory and non-migratory populations. They were able to find some outlier regions in the genomes, including this really nice 21 kb region that corresponds, or all of the resident populations share these derived alleles related to collagen production in their wing muscles. So it's a really nice story. So the question that I'm asking in this presentation is whether these Pacific Island populations, which became established relatively recently, will show evidence for contemporary changes in their wing morphology with that transition from migratory to non-migratory status. And so the sampling locations here, I've got a bunch of individuals from the migratory North American population, and these other three more distantly or established long ago resident populations in Central and South America and the Caribbean, and then a lot of individuals from Pacific Islands as well. And what the actual data that I'm working with looks like. skins and just photographs of those individuals, but then also some live caught individuals from contemporary populations. I'm mostly interested in the four wings, and to describe wing morphology, I'm using principal components to describe both the size and the shape of their four wings. So in all of the figures that I'm going to show, there'll be the size principal component, where a large value corresponds to a large forewing, and a small value is a small forewing. And then the shape principal component, where a high value is are these sort of pointed, elongated wings, and small values are these more rounded wings. And what you can see in this plot here for the size principal component is that the migratory North American individuals tend to have forewings that are larger than all of these other resident non-migratory populations of butterflies. Similarly, with their the shape, the North American individuals tend to have these more elongated wings. But just sort of squinting and looking at this plot, you can definitely tell that the Pacific Island populations are somewhat of an outlier among the resident populations. And so one possible reason for that, as I was saying before, is that they're just more recently established, and they're potentially still evolving towards this like resident optimum for wing morphology. And so one thing I can do with all of the museum specimens is put together time series. And conveniently, since they're so recently established, you don't have to go too far back in time to get fairly close to their arrival date on these islands. And so in all of these plots, again, I've got the size and the shape principal components through time. And what you can see is that for these Pacific islands, where I actually have enough samples and covering a wide enough time range, in Hawaii and New Caledonia, you see the significant decrease in the size of their wings. And in all four of those islands, in all four of these island groups, you see a significant decreases in the shape principal component. So their wings are becoming more round through time. The other cool thing to note here is that, so this dotted line corresponds to the North American mean. And what you can see for the shape principal component is that all of these populations cross over that North American mean line. So the individuals that are becoming established in these locations are potentially actually more elongated than the North American mean. And they're potentially the best dispersers, but then they're evolving towards this more resident phenotype. Australia, as I mentioned before, is this cool case because within southern Australia, you actually do get freezing temperatures. The milkweeds that they feed on die back, and they have to carry out a short distance migration. And so Australia is neat because for the size and the shape in these resident populations, you see the same pattern as you do in the other Pacific islands, where it seems like they're becoming smaller and more round, but those migratory individuals, where they are still having to do seasonal movements, don't show those changes. And that's reflected in these significant interactions between migratory status and year in Australia. So another thing you might want to consider thinking about this is that there are all of these other non-resident or resident populations that you can look at. So if you consider Caribbean and South American and Central American populations and look at these same time series sort of across the board, they're all uniformly smaller and rounder than the North American mean. And also, even though some of them look like they're showing directional changes through time, it's not consistent across those populations. So it seems like in these populations where they have been established as residents for much longer, they're more or less just sort of drifting. So the next steps that I'm working on are, I have about 300 samples that I've sent off for sequencing. And so I'll be able to generate a bunch of RADseq data from the ancestral North American population and also all of these derived resident populations on Pacific Islands. And that will be important because it can tell me more about how the Pacific Island populations are related to the ancestral North American population, and then also how those Pacific Island populations are related to one another. So I'll be able to take those neutral allele frequency data from the island populations and ask, for example, how related the island populations are to themselves and how much you should expect drift to happen within those populations. So just to wrap it up and give some conclusions, here I hope I've shown you that these Pacific Island monarch butterflies are different from other resident populations in their wing morphology, potentially due to the recentness of their introductions, and that time series data suggests that there is contemporary evolution of smaller and rounder wings happening in these monarch butterfly populations. And so with that, I'd just like to thank some funding sources, and a special shout out to the Rosemary Grant Award from the Society for the Study of Evolution, and to the Strauss and the Ramirez labs at UC Davis for a lot of really great ideas, really extensive list of collections, and all the curators of those places have been really great. Yeah, and with that, I will take any questions that you might have. Yeah, that's a good question, and there's some papers about this that sort of the suggestion is that the number of migratory butterflies that you see within North America is itself a somewhat recent phenomenon that has to do with sort of the clearing of forests in eastern North America, their conversion to agriculture, that provided a really good habitat for the milkweed host plants, and so just sort of, and there is some also sort of genomic data suggesting that there are recent increases in their effective population size within North America. So I think the idea is just that instead of hundreds of thousands of individuals, more recently there were tens of millions or billions of individuals, and just the chance that an off-course migrant ended up on these islands was higher. The other part of it is that humans definitely did introduce probably the milkweed host plants that they feed on the islands. And so that itself was probably a relatively recent phenomenon. Yeah.
Do you know when the non-migratory populations in Central and South America were established? Or when, or do you have an idea of when that was?
There's some genomic data suggesting that it was like the split between North America and those other resident populations was like 5,000 to 10,000 years ago. But yeah, I don't think it's super well. But yeah, the thought is also that monarchs ancestrally are migratory, and they probably always carried out like a sort of a short distance migration within Mexico and the southeastern United States.
Some of your islands seem to have a lot harder selective pressures on shape versus size or vice versa. Is there any research into what about the environment on that particular island?
Yeah, I haven't thought too much about particular aspects of the island. I've looked some at island size, and that does, it is a significant predictor of a lot of, like if you look within the Pacific Islands, the ones that are especially small tend to have even smaller and more round-winged butterflies, although that's mostly driven by like really large islands like Papua New Guinea and Hawaii. There are also potentially differences in predation by things like birds. So in some of these Pacific Island groups, they have really, they might have sort of depauperate insectivorous bird faunas. I'd like to figure when that arose and whether it was in sort of like the first stepping stone or whether it convergently arose in all of the islands after it got there.